Okay, you probably realized pretty quickly that the clip you just saw was doctored with someone else's face, mine, swapped in for Patrick Swayze's starring role in Dirty Dancing. After all, that guy is pretty recognizable, just like this guy.
I want to see you climb this. Not easy to do.
I've been back in the recording studio. Been making real music again. It's gonna drop on Sunday.
But that's not really Tom Cruise. Those videos you just saw are examples of deepfakes, which is a broad term to describe media that's manipulated or created using computer programs trained to make them look or sound as real as possible. You can apply this technology to video, audio, or images, and clearly you can have some fun with it. Creating videos like these are as simple as uploading your photo to an app. But what's entertainment in the hands of one person could be weaponized to spread misinformation by someone else. And as deepfakes have become more realistic, the technology has been used to target people. So what happens when it becomes impossible to tell whether what you're looking at is real or fake? That question keeps Hany Farid up at night. He's a professor at the University of California, Berkeley, studying disinformation campaigns and manipulated media. And he's been following the progression of deepfakes for years.
The term deepfake sort of came upon around 2015. And so what we've been seeing is every 6 months or so, the technology becomes more accessible. So today, there's half a dozen apps out there. They're not great. They're okay. They're fine. But they're getting better. I mean, if you had looked at the deepfakes 3 years ago, you'd be like, this is sort of cute, but I'm not too worried. 3 years later, you've got the Tom Cruise TikTok deepfakes. They are truly brilliant. And they are at the canary in the coal mine, if you will, of what is to come. It is coming.
There are already some examples of sophisticated deepfakes being used by bad actors in a big way. For example, in 2020, criminals reportedly used deep faked audio to scam a bank out of $35 million. The most common targets of deep fakes today aren't businesses or celebrities or politicians, though. They're regular people. The common name for it is revenge porn.
People creating non-consensual intimate imagery or non-consensual pornography, where they're taking the likeness primarily of women, whether that is a politician, journalist, human rights activist, somebody who's attracted unwanted attention, and taking their likeness and splatting it into sexually explicit material and then carpet bombing the internet with it as a form of weaponization.
Yeah. So right now, do you think we are kind of past the point where human beings can identify a good deep fake?
And I mean, yes. I think if we are not past the tipping point, we are really close. We just are just finishing a study on determining whether the average person, even with training, so we train them on what deep fake images look like, people are now unable to determine whether a static face is computer synthesized, deep fake, or a real face.
The good news is, experts like Hany have been preparing for the moment that deepfakes become impossible for the average person to identify. The bad news for us is there's only so much they can share about what they've been working on.
Let me say, by the way, there's some tension here. When you ask me how do I detect fakes and I tell you, well, I also empower the forger to make better fakes. And so there's always a little bit of tension in this game.
Hany was able to share that his work is focused on identifying deepfakes of high-profile individuals like President Biden or Mark Zuckerberg, since that sort of content could have serious geopolitical or even financial impacts.
So video of a world leader saying, I've launched nuclear weapons against country X. And that goes viral on Twitter, YouTube, TikTok, Facebook, whatever it is. And before anybody thinks maybe we should check to determine this is real or not, we're off to the races. Now, look, do I think that that's likely? No. But is it out of the question? No. And so what we do is we build what we call behavioral models of things like head motions and facial expressions and how the hands are moving. For example, if I put President Biden's face onto my face, well, it may look like Biden, but all the expressions and the hand motions are mine. Yeah. They're not his. And so we build these what we call soft biometric models based on behavioral mannerisms to identify a Biden, a Harris, a Zuckerberg, a Bezos, a relatively small number of people worldwide, so that when a deep fake makes it out there, we have a mechanism to say, well, we don't think it's this person.
These models could potentially prevent some of the worst-case deep fake scenarios on a global scale. However, this approach depends on people accepting that the fact check is true, despite how realistic the deep fake might have appeared to them. And that is a challenge, especially as Americans have lost trust in institutions like the government and traditional media. Meanwhile, social media has made it easy to amplify unverified content.
If we enter a world where videos and audio and images can be manipulated, then anything can be manipulated and nothing has to be true. So if I see a video, for example, and I don't like what that says about my politician or my favorite performer, it's a deep fake, right? That's easy. That's really easy to dismiss.
So at this point, would your advice be to people who are on social media, they see an image? You know, usually I tell people, if it gets a big rise out of you in one way or another, just hold on, right? Stop. Like don't automatically share it and forward it to your friends.
Well, my advice is get off of TikTok, get off of Facebook, get off of Twitter, get off of YouTube. You will be much, much happier, and you will be amazed at how many hours you have left in the day, by the way. I think you have to approach everything you read online with a grain of salt. You have to treat the way you see things the same way you read things, right? Is that we have to start taking our responsibilities online more seriously. And the fact is that sure, lots of hoaxes out there. You know, who cares, right? Who cares if the video of a guy jumping off his bike into a car is fake or not? It's fine. But that same pattern of behavior ends up showing up in much, much more dangerous ways when we are talking about, for example, the pandemic, the election, and things that have real life consequences.
So we might not be able to stop the deep fakes from being made or even be able to identify them by sight. But we do have the power to reduce the spread of this potentially misleading or malicious content. If you do think you've come across an unlabeled deepfake on social media, check the site or app's guidelines. Platforms, including Facebook and Twitter, have pledged to remove manipulated media that they consider harmful. Clearly, it's not always easy to do, but until next time, try to keep it real. I'm Hari Srinivasan, and this is Take on Fake. Thanks for watching.